Hello and welcome to the Special Delivery Damn Near Daily Podcast. I am your host, Special, and this is day number 17 of the Special Delivery 30-Day Podcast Challenge, where I'm just trying to give you 30 podcasts in about 30 days or so. Past episodes have been with everyone from SZA, Earth Gang, Vince Staples, and so many more. Plus, I like to do episodes highlighting all the new music that's dropped in the past 24 hours or so. So if you like that, make sure to hit that follow or subscribe button on whatever you're listening on and check out some past episodes. This episode is with Sid. I got to catch up with her when she was in town for the Always Never Home tour, and we got to talk about everything from why she named the album Finn, why she chose to do Always Never Home as just a little three song project. We also got to talk about how she chose Buddy to come on tour with her, and we got to talk about how she's grown as a performer and the different performers that she watches to try to learn from. So let's hop into it.
Now we got to talk about the music. You dropped an album and an EP. I want to talk about Finn first, because I was doing research, reading through, and like, I think a lot of people, or maybe it's just me, thought that Finn was, I think it's like the French word for end. Yeah. But then I read that you look at it as like a fish fin, and you were really inspired by like water. So what was the thought process more behind that?
I came up with the title on tour. I was on tour with the internet, and I think I was like brushing my teeth or something, and and I was just thinking of words that somehow, I don't know, had meaning to like water, because I had a lot of water references on the album. Mm-hmm. Not really on purpose, just happened that way. So I wanted something that reflected that, but also something that, you know, reflected me and where I was in my life at the time. So I remember telling the band the album title. We were in Iceland.
Oh, wow.
And a hot spring.
Oh, wow.
We were swimming in a hot spring in Iceland.
Nice.
And I was like, I want to call the album Finn. And it like, again, in water, it made the most sense to me. I feel like the role that I play in the internet is somewhat of a leader with me and Matt. But I think just, I'm the first one you usually see when people mention the internet. Same with the shark's fin. That's usually the first thing you see. And I do my best to help steer us in the right directions, and so I felt like that word was just the best way to describe me at the time, especially with us all putting out solo albums and having to stick together as one vessel throughout it.
It just keeps developing and developing, where it's like, it's a cool word, but there's water, but yeah, like, I just love that. It's so, so cool. And then on this project, or on both these projects, you talked about how these wouldn't quite fit on like an internet project. That's why they're on your project. And I think the internet does some sexy stuff, but like, this was really sexy. Was that a conscious thing? Like, because you talked about how the water just kind of happened with all those references. Was like the sexy thing, like, I want to do sexy songs, or it just kind of happened?
It just happened.
Yeah.
I think the way I approached every song on the album was just pretty carefree. Mm-hmm. And part of the reason is because I wasn't necessarily writing these songs for me. I was writing them kind of for practice, and also to see who else would sound good singing this, because I really want to write for other artists in the present and future, if possible. So this for me was more of like a, let me showcase my versatility as a songwriter.
Definitely.
None of it was completely conscious. It was just like, oh, this song's tight, but it's not an internet song. So now what?
What was the distinction between Finn and Always Never Home? Why those three songs to kind of like put out later on?
On the Road was a little bit too, didn't feel like it fit on Finn for me. Mm-hmm. I made it at the same time, and it was kind of meant for that album, but listening to the album as a whole, it just didn't completely feel right in that body of work, so I saved it for later. Moving Mountains, I think I had at the same time, but also I think the issue with Moving Mountains was that there was a sample in it. And I was too scared to put any samples on my album, just because, you know, honestly, I was gonna drop Always Never Home for free. That was the plan, and all the producers were cool with it. And then Sony at the last minute just was like, fine, we'll put it out. So shout out to them. No looking back, I actually made after Finn was out already.
Gotcha.
Bad Dream, I had been sitting on for a long time and didn't know where to go with it. Mm. What I put on there is all I had written to that beat, and I didn't really know what to do with it afterwards, so I realized it was in a similar key as No Looking Back. Just was like, all right, let me fuse these together and just like, whatever. Might as well.
It works out perfectly, so. Thanks. And you're on the Always Never Home tour now with Buddy, who is incredible. I'm like obsessed with his music. Like, it's crazy. What was it like choosing him to tour with?
Well, I had just done a song with him when I was picking my openers and got word that he was down. So I was like, yeah, sure. Our session was hella cool. Just felt real natural being in his kind of environment and his zone. So yeah, it just made sense. And now that he's on the tour and we've done a few shows, it's really perfect.
Nice. And then you posted that you feel like you've grown as a performer. How do you feel like you've grown?
My voice has gotten a lot stronger over the years. And I've always been studying live performances, my favorite live performers.
Who would you say are some of your favorite live performers?
D'Angelo is one. Like Justin Timberlake, Erykah Badu, Prince, absolutely. Yeah, it's a lot. Lately, I've been mostly studying Prince. I've been studying James Brown.
Man.
I get on YouTube, and when I don't have much else to do, I just sit and let the concert play.
Yes.
And I've been just trying to point out the things that I like the most of their performances and see like, oh, that's a cool idea to ask the audience to do that or whatever. So yeah, I've just been
trying to
throw
a cape on you.
Yeah. I can't steal that from James, but some stuff like that, you know, like there's definitely some things that I've like taken from D'Angelo concerts and stuff like that. Just trying to keep coming out of my show and keep putting as much emotion into my performance as I can.
I think that's interesting too, because I had read you were talking about how on this tour you wanted to be like super energetic and like get out there like you used to do when you DJ'd for Odd Future, but women covered, they want to be serenaded. So it's like that D'Angelo James Brown comparison like works out well, because you want to do all the James Brown shit, but like you're just going to do the D'Angelo shit and have a good time with this.
So. I gotta just sing too for the most part.
Yeah.
I've realized that they still want energy from me. And if I do my thing well enough and if I have fun by myself, that they'll just join in eventually.
Yeah. I mean, they love it. They came for you, period. So, you know what I mean? Yay, thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
And thank you so much for checking out this episode of the Special Delivery Podcast. I also did an episode of my game show, Special Education with Sid, so that link will be in the show notes. Also, hit me up letting me know what your favorite part of this episode was. I'm on Twitter at Special Says and on Instagram and Snapchat. Those are at Special Says as well. And if you haven't already, make sure to hit that follow or subscribe button on whatever you're listening on.